Good morning. Friends, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us be glad in it. I am so glad to see you here, those of you who are gathered in our great hall, and for those of you who are watching online, we are glad that you are worshiping in that way with us this morning as well. Let me just remind you of a couple of things. First of all, our session continues to ask us to wear masks indoors, so thank you for abiding by that and honoring that. Let me also remind you that next week we are moving our schedule back to the times that we had before the pandemic. So at 9 o'clock, we are having our first worship service. We're still going to hold on for the drive-in for a while because with the new variant that's come out, we are aware that some people aren't quite ready to come back indoors as we had originally planned. So drive-in is going to be starting at 9 o'clock next week. So those of you who prefer drive-in, come at 9 o'clock and not 9:30. It will still be in the parking lot. Then from 10 to 11, we'll be having our educational time, Sunday school classes. We'll start meeting then from 10 to 11, and then we'll have 11 o'clock in here in the Great Hall. So that begins next week. We are celebrating communion next week, so those of you who are online may want to have bread and juice or wine ready so that you can celebrate along with us. Most of you were probably here earlier, but not everybody. We had a wonderful recital. Timothy Miller, our guest soloist, was here. It was a wonderful celebration of some wonderful music, so we are glad to have Timothy here with us. Brent Runnels is here to accompany. He is head of the music department at Oglethorpe. So we had a twofer in terms of wonderful music earlier. Timothy will be singing an anthem in our service this morning, so we are glad that he is here. Timothy is a native of Augusta, Georgia. He has sung all over the world. He is assistant professor of music and voice at Morehouse. And some of you, if you weren't here earlier, know him because he sings. He sings today at the seventh inning stretch, God Bless America, and so after he finishes here, he has to head down and do that. So we'll see him there, but we are so grateful that you have been a part of our time this morning. Thank you for doing that. Those are all of our announcements this morning. Friends, let us now prepare our hearts for the worship of God. Would you join with me in the call to worship printed in your bulletin? And I have one more thing to mention. We're having some technical difficulties with the screen, and it's not projecting. So the words are all in your bulletin to sing along with. Usually we have them projected up here, but we're not going to have that. It's part of our service this Sunday, and we'll have it fixed by next week. But bear with us with that this morning. Would you join with me in our call to worship printed in your bulletin? Wake up! No more dozing off. The time is now. The kingdom is here. There are songs to be sung, chains to be broken, children to be loved, hungry to be fed. It's time to come alive. We are somebody, God's people, empowered and blessed, called and sent. Wake up, sing, pray, act. I invite you to stand if you are able. Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, what a wonderful song to remind us of the goodness of God's creation. And yet we're also reminded that God is recreating every day, because as good as God makes creation and calls us to be, we wander. And so we recognize that we wander and that we have a need for a Savior, and trust that God will recreate our hearts in this moment of worship. Please join me in our prayer of confession. Wake us, O God. Wake us from the busyness that already threatens to obscure the simple splendor of your love. Wake us to the truth about ourselves, that we give in to the pressure of culture to buy more than we need, to give mainly to those who give to us, and to spend more time shopping online than praying. We confess that we need your love to refocus us, to turn our eyes to those who struggle, and to teach us to listen to those whose pain knows no words. Wake us to remember, to repent, and to walk faithfully with you. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the good news is that we can trust our God, that God not only listens, but that God hears us and forgives us. Friends, hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Please be seated.
This time I'd like to invite any of our young people to come join me down front in the circle, or anybody who's young at heart, come on down. It's so nice when people actually listen to what I say and take it seriously. So let's get everyone to say what we say every Sunday morning. You know what? What? God loves you and God loves me. I've got something here that some of you may know, but some of you may not recognize. Do you know what this is? Do you guys know what this is? An alarm clock. You are so right. So do you know how it works? You know what makes it go? Does it have a battery in it maybe? Actually, this one doesn't. Does it look like it plugs in anywhere? Solar panel. Do you see a solar panel there somewhere? So how do you think it works? Any ideas? I'm sorry? Well, it's got gears in it, yeah, but it has something. You actually wind it up, and then when it goes off, it sounds like... especially because today I'm thinking about what would you use that for? Why do you use an alarm clock? Yep. To wake up in the morning. You're exactly right, Will. To go to school or to go to work or to do something that you want to do. Yeah, so I was wondering, I really wanted to surprise people with it, see if anybody was asleep out there. Have y'all seen anybody sleeping out there too? We're going to read a story from the Bible in just a minute. It's a letter in which John is writing to a church, and he tells them to wake up. Now, he doesn't ring an alarm clock, but he wants them to wake up and remember that God loves them and that God wants them to love other people too. And I think that's something we need to be reminded of from time to time. We almost need an alarm clock that goes off sometimes, and it just goes off, and we say, hey, what does that remind me of? It reminds me that God loves me
And God wants me to love other people as well. So I hope that when you get up for your alarm clock tomorrow at school or whatever, you'll remember how much God loves each one of you and how much you can love God as well. Let's say a prayer together, too. Let's bow our heads. Thank you, God, for these young and young at heart. Thank you for how you love us. Help us to wake up to those around us who need your love. We pray this in your name. Amen. You can either go with Miss Allison to Children's Church, or you can go back to your seats.
Amen. And thank you. As both a pastor and a pastor father, I appreciate a pastor's son singing so beautifully and doing his father proud. When we hear the word preached and the word sung, that is the word proclaimed. Now we will hear the word read this morning, continuing in the book of Revelation from the third chapter, verses 1 through 6. Listen for God's word to us, inspired by the Spirit and passed down to us, trusting in its understanding. To the angel of the church in Sardis write, "These are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me, dressed in white, for they are worthy. The one who is victorious will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out the name of that person from the book of life, but will acknowledge that name before my Father and his angels. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Would you join with me in prayer? Holy God, as we have heard this word read, these strange, unusual words from the book of Revelation, open our hearts, our imaginations, open our eyes to see things we have not seen before. Help us to wake up to the moving of your Holy Spirit, that we might know your love and do your work in our world today. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. George Wirth, one of my good friends, the former pastor of First Presbyterian Church of Atlanta, tells one of my favorite stories of something that happened to him when he was driving downtown through Atlanta, and he happened to see a church that had a sign out front that proclaimed, "The Perfect Church." George was surprised. He said he didn't know such a church actually existed. So he parked his car, made his way to the front door, and knocked on it, but no one answered. So he went around to the sign door. He knocked again. Nobody was there. He looked in the windows. He walked over to what appeared to be a children's playground, but there was no one in sight. The place was empty. Later on that night, he called the church, but he couldn't reach anybody. And then he tried again the next morning, but there was just no answer. All at once, it occurred to him he might have figured out how to create the perfect church. Simply put a sign with the name on it in front of the building, apply for a tax exemption, and then don't let anybody in. Because without people, he said, there would be no problems, no pressures, no fights, no financial difficulties, no conflicts, or no controversies. It would be the perfect church. Well, maybe not. But when John writes this letter we have just read to the church at Sardis, the one we've just read this morning, describing them as a church that has a reputation of being alive, and yet you are dead, would there be some similarity between that church and the perfect church that George Wirth described? New Testament scholar William Barclay describes the city of Sardis during this time as as a formerly great city that had fallen into a state of degeneration. Barclay says the wealth of Sardis was legendary. The city was built high on a rock. It made it very difficult for anyone to attack it. But over time, it was actually defeated in battle. It had become complacent and flabby. And when John writes to this city, and he writes this letter, they are still wealthy, but they are in a period of decline. So Barclay says, the once great citadel was now only an ancient monument on the top. There was no life or spirit there. The once great Sardians were soft, and twice they had lost their city because they were just too lazy to watch out. Too lazy to watch out. And Barclay goes on to suggest that the church in Sardis exhibited some of the same qualities of the city. So, what are the words that John has for this church in Sardis? And what are the words that he passes along that John says come from Jesus himself? What does he say? Wake up. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die. For I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold fast and repent. Wake up. Pay attention to what is going on in your life, both as individual followers of Christ and as the church. Wake up. It's as if John is ringing the alarm clock loudly, because the people in Sardis, in this manner of their spiritual life and death, he's saying this is important, so wake up. John even lays out for them what it looks like for them to wake up. First, it happens by becoming aware of what is going on around them. That's where it begins, but it doesn't end there. He tells them, remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. What they have received and heard is the good news of the gospel. The good news that God so loves the world that God sent Jesus into the world to be the Savior of the world. And Jesus came into this world that God created good, but over time it had degenerated because of sin and brokenness. And God's loving plan is for Jesus to come to teach us how to live, to give his life on a cross in order to address the powers of sin and brokenness once and for all, and to be raised up on that first Easter. And after Jesus ascends back to be with God the Father, God then sends the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the risen Christ, to infuse us, to guide us, and to empower us to make real the kingdom of God, which is God's way of making things right the way they should be. That's the good news that these early Christians had heard and received. But apparently they become complacent, and it's time for them to wake up to what is going on. Maybe that message is kind of like the technology we find in some cars today, that if you know you fall asleep and you're driving, an alarm goes off and it says, hey, you're driving off the road, so you don't run into someone else or hurt yourself. But once we remember what we have received and heard, John then tells us to hold fast. Hold fast. Don't let this world-changing truth slip out of your hands. While I absolutely believe that we are saved by God's grace and that God is holding fast to us, I also believe that we are required day by day, moment by moment, to hold fast to the God who is already holding fast to us. I love the story of the little girl. She and her father were out walking and they were about to cross a bridge. The father was kind of concerned for the little girl, so he asked his daughter, he said, sweetheart, please hold my hand so you don't fall into the river. But the little girl said, no, Daddy, you hold on to my hand. And the dad said, what's the difference? And she said, there's a big difference. If I hold your hand and something happens to me, chances are that I may let your hand go. But if you hold my hand, I know for sure that no matter what happens, you will never let my hand go. Friends, God will never let us go. But we need to hold on to this good news that guides the way that we walk through this life. Later in the passage, John records what Jesus says about those who remain faithful. It says, they will walk with me. They will walk with me. I'm reminded of that great Thomas Dorsey hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. And not only describe Dorsey's own struggle with the loss of a loved one, but it paints this wonderful picture of how we walk hand in hand through life with Christ, especially through the hard times. John also records Jesus' words about how to wake us up by not only remembering, not only holding fast, but he also says we are to repent, to repent. In recent months, we've talked about what it means to repent. It doesn't mean just to feel bad about something or show remorse. It can include those things. But the Greek word from the New Testament really means that we are to think differently in order that we may act differently. It means to wake up and to see things from God's perspective. But it doesn't stop there. Our seeing and thinking differently needs to result in acting differently, in walking differently, in following the lead of Jesus. It means, really, to change. To change. Now, change, as some have suggested, change is always experienced to some degree as a sense of loss, even good change. Even when the change is good, there's a sense of losing something, which is often why we always seem to resist change. There are different kinds of change. A number of years ago, Ron Heifetz, who teaches at Harvard Business School, who's also a medical doctor as well as a classically trained musician, he has used his gifts well, I think, but he wrote one of the best leadership books I've ever read, along with Marty Linsky. It's called Leadership on the Line. Leadership on the Line. And in order to talk about the understanding of change, he told this story in an article in the Harvard Business Review. To stay alive, Jack Pritchard had to change his life. Triple bypass surgery and medication could help. The heart surgeon told him, but no technical fix could release Pritchard from his own responsibility for changing the habits of a lifetime. He had to stop smoking, improve his diet, get some exercise, take time to relax, remembering to breathe deeply during the day. Pritchard's doctor could provide sustaining technical expertise and take supportive action, but only Pritchard could adapt his ingrained habits to improve his long-term health. The doctor faced the leadership task of mobilizing the patient to make critical behavioral changes. Jack Pritchard faced the adaptive work of figuring out which specific changes to make and how to incorporate them in his daily life. In the professional world, the terms technical fix and adaptive change have become commonplace. A technical fix is something that takes expertise and knowledge, in this case, like prescribing medicine or performing surgery. It's something the surgeon could do to help. But the adaptive change was something that only Jack Pritchard could do to change his life. He had to choose to change based on that information that had been shared with him. The surgeon could not make that change for him. He could only offer the pathway to change. When it comes to repentance, I believe that God is like the great physician who has great training and expertise. God has already sent Jesus into the world to die on the cross, and God offers us that saving grace. But it's up to us to openly receive God's grace and then to run with it. And that is a day by day, hour by hour, minute by minute, step by step, lifelong process that transforms us into the women and the men God created and called each one of us to become. You know, it's as if we heard the good news from the great physician. The good news begins with God's love for us and the whole world. And then the bad news is that the world is filled with sin and brokenness, And every one of us needs forgiveness and grace. But then the good news, again, is that God knows how to take care of that. And God offers us this grace and forgiveness. And the good news is also that through God's Holy Spirit and the work of God's grace, we can make the adaptive changes in our lives and we can repent. And if we do this, it will lead to a meaningful and purposeful life in which God walks with us all the way. It won't be easy, but it will be good. And if we wake up to the good news, whether we're hearing it this morning for the first time, or whether we may have slipped away or dozed off spiritually, we can remember what is still alive, to use John's language. We can nourish and water our faith and do the things that Christ has modeled for us and Christ calls each one of us to do. So today, I want us to think, first of all, where we as individuals are called by God to wake up in our own lives. Maybe during the pandemic, we've just gotten out of practice in our walk with God. If you're hearing this sermon today, the good news is that it's not too late. Like visiting the doctor, we are hearing this good news from the book of Revelation that through God's grace, we've caught it in time, and there's a treatment. However, it will require us to change, to make that adaptive change, to do things differently in response to God's grace. So how is God calling each one of us to wake up, to remember, to hold fast, to repent? You know, this whole idea of waking up is one that we hear talked about a lot in our world today. During the season of Lent, I mentioned the book that I have listed under the recommended reading on your bulletin this morning. It's Esau Macaulay's wonderful book, Reading While Black. Macaulay is an African-American who grew up in Alabama. He's now a priest in the Anglican Church of North America, as well as the assistant professor of New Testament at Wheaton College, which is one of the preeminent evangelical colleges in the world. And as I shared with many of you during the season of Lent, in which we looked at a number of passages from the Bible that touched on some of the things that Macaulay writes about, Macaulay helped me wake up and see passages from the Bible I had read my whole life, but had never fully seen before. Through Scripture, he helped me wake up to what was there the whole time. I just missed it. Macaulay has a wonderful gift of gently but firmly inviting and challenging us to wake up to Scripture. Maybe that's one place where we as Christians need to wake up in order to fully understand what it means not only to love God, but to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Also, how might God be calling the church to wake up? It is not lost on me that Sardis was a very wealthy city when it slipped into complacency. Wealth and comfort can do that. Here in Johns Creek, we need to be watchful. We live in an affluent city in an affluent nation. William Barclay talks about how often this idea of waking up and being watchful is found throughout Scripture again and again. Wake up, watch out, be watchful. To put it another way, waking up is a biblical value. Waking up is a biblical value. It's at the core of what it means to be a Christ follower. And finally, how might God be calling us as the larger church of Jesus Christ to wake up? When people think of the Christian church, particularly those who are not Christians, what do they think of? Do we as the church exhibit a faith that is alive with the love of Christ for others? Or do we look like a church that is dying and seems to have lost its way? Friends, the essence of how we are to live as Christians is always what Jesus said when he was asked, "What's the most important commandment of them all. Love God and love your neighbor as you love yourself. So where do we need to wake up when it comes to loving God and loving our neighbor in the same way that we love ourselves? As we said, waking up is at the core of the Christian faith. In some ways, it all goes back to the resurrection. And the resurrection of Jesus points to our own resurrection as followers of Christ. Life on that final day of resurrection. John Claypool tells one of my favorite stories that I often use at a funeral. He talks about how Winston Churchill planned his own funeral. It was to take place in St. Paul's Cathedral. Churchill included many of the great hymns of the Anglican Church, and he used the eloquent Anglican liturgy. But at his direction, a bugler, positioned high in the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral, played, after the benediction, the sound of taps, the universal signal that the day is over. But then came the most dramatic turn, as Churchill had instructed. As soon as taps was finished, another bugler, high on the other side of the dome, played the notes, "Reveille! It's time to get up. It's time to get up. It's time to get up in the morning." That was Churchill's testimony that at the end of history, the last note will not be taps, it will be reveille. As John Claypool says, the worst things are never the last things. One day, we believe as Christians that one day we will wake up on the other side of death. And as the great song puts it, what a morning that will be. But until then, may we wake up to the things that God is calling us to do here and now, which show the love of Christ for our world. In the strong name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. We thank you, God, that you loved this world, that you still love this world. Lord, show us where we need to wake up, how we need to love one another as Christ loved us and as Christ showed us. May we wake up to those things here and now. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, we don't just set alarm clocks. We awaken one another as God's community of faith. And one of the ways that we do that is to remind one another what it is that we believe as we go out into our weeks and tell the world with our lives. Let us stand as we are able and say together our affirmation of faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. When we come together for worship, we have the opportunity, the privilege, and the responsibility to pray for one another in God's world, in our nation, and in our family of faith. Let us go to God in prayer. Dear Lord, you do not call us to be perfect, but to be alive and awake. You call us not to be people with a carefully cultivated good reputation, but doing good work, following you, and not leaving tasks unfinished. Help us value being awake rather than mocking being awake in you. Woken by your calling to examine ourselves, our thinking, our culture, systems of sin and injustice, and people, places, and parts of your creation in need. When we see injustice, help us to be awake, to see not only when people are evil and cruel and divisive and dismissive, bigoted and abusive, but to see when we benefit from the current and former cruelty, and to humbly seek to repent, to reconcile, to love and offer tangible compassion. When we see your creation in shambles, exploited, diminished, and dying, help us not only to come to the rescue, but to lead lives of sacrifice, to wake up and make changes to change our world. Take us by your hand and lead us to radical change personally and as your people. By your Spirit, awaken our minds so we can change and heal our hearts, especially when those changes are hard and life-saving. When we are asleep, wake us up to follow you hand in hand, transformed into new people, and not be those that are still living in brokenness and in dirty clothes, which we cling to or benefit from. We pray this in the name of your Son, who showed us how to sacrifice all, and to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand and sing.
As we finish worship today, I just want to remind you that the way we're doing the offering during the service is we're receiving at the end. We're not passing the offering plates yet. So I want to say thank you for your generous giving, whether it's giving here, whether it's giving online through our website at the Give Now button you can click, or mailing in a check or dropping it by the Welcome Center. These are all ways that you can continue to support God's work here at Johns Creek Presbyterian Church. If you want to find out what it means to be a part of our church family, what it means to be a follower of Christ, if you want to talk to one of the pastors, Brian and I will be out back. We'd love to talk with you about those things. If you want to talk with Stephen Minister, Eloise Newton is standing right over here. She'd be glad to talk with you following the service. She's trained to listen, to care, to pray, to offer support. You can find a place to go talk with her following the service. As we leave this place today, I want to remind you two words. Wake up. Wake up. Be open to the things that God is bringing to your mind, to your heart, to your soul as you move through this week. Look for the opportunities not only to see God's love for you, not only to see this beautiful creation, but to see how you can show God's love for others, especially your neighbor. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Have a great day.